Well, dear friends in Christ, grace to you and peace. Amen. It's the third week in Advent, and we've been taking a line from that Christmas hymn, O Little Town of Bethlehem, that says, the hopes and fears of all the years are met in thee tonight. Today we're talking about the hopes and fears of Mary. And sometime this morning, maybe during the offering, read through that gospel message again. From Luke chapter 2, I know it's read every Christmas, but wanted to read that again and focus on some of the details or lack of details in that story, the way that Luke tells it about the birth of Jesus. It was during that time when Emperor Augustus, or Caesar Augustus, made a decree that all the world should be enrolled. Now, that decree, that census, served two purposes. First, it helped the young men get a list of the young men who would be drafted into the Roman army. And second, it was a census so that they would know how many people could pay taxes or needed to pay taxes. So Mary and Joseph, being Jews, Joseph was not going to be drafted into the Roman army because, of course, they were Jewish, but they had to pay taxes. So their journey brought them from Nazareth to Bethlehem because he was of the house and lineage of David. Now, the interesting thing is that because it was for serving in the army, Roman army, and to pay taxes, that Mary did not need to make the trip. The men were counted, not the women. Women were not required to show up for the census because back in those days, patriarchal world, only the men were counted, only the men served in the army, only the men paid taxes. So what was Joseph thinking when he brought Mary, his pregnant fiance, with him on this journey from Nazareth to Bethlehem when he didn't need to do so? Well, remember last week we talked about the nature of Mary being pregnant when she was engaged, but not that third stage like we talked about last week of being married. Mary being married to Joseph. Remember that they were from a small town and that being pregnant outside of marriage could have had humiliating, even deathly consequences. Joseph had agreed that he and Mary would get married, but at this phase they were engaged. Imagine if Joseph weren't there, the gossip that might erupt whenever people saw Mary when Joseph was away traveling to the census. Imagine the humiliating whispers, the embarrassing finger-pointing, the shameful and rude comments that might have been made about Mary. Remember that the penalty for being married, for being pregnant outside of marriage, was being stoned. So it's likely that it wasn't totally safe for Mary to stay there alone in Nazareth by herself while Joseph took that trip to be enrolled in the census. Nonetheless, Joseph took Mary with him to protect their yet unborn child. That was Mary's situation, and that probably was Joseph's response. Now, I don't want to ruin some of what we already know about the Christmas story, but what I'd like to do is focus on some details that are there and also some details that aren't necessarily there. For instance, we know that this is how Mary and Joseph got to Bethlehem. Mary and Joseph, Mary riding on the back of a donkey. But what's interesting is that that detail about the donkey is not in the Christmas story in Luke or Matthew. When I was looking up things for the sermon today, I found there's no donkey that's there in the Bible. I read through Luke and Matthew again because they're the only ones who tell about the birth of Jesus. Because I always thought that the detail about the donkey was there, but it's not there. I was crushed to find out that that detail was left out of the gospel text. Walking might have been difficult. Riding on a donkey might have also been difficult. But pregnant as Mary was, that 80-mile trek, whether she walked or whether she did indeed ride a donkey, the detail is not there actually in the Bible. But what we do know is that it's about 80 miles from Nazareth to Bethlehem. 80 miles that Joseph and the pregnant Mary took so that he could be enrolled with, so that he could be enrolled to, in order to pay taxes. Now, that trek of 80 miles would have taken about, you know, 4 or 5 days. Undoubtedly, it was a difficult journey. There were some, you can see Nazareth up at the top, you can see Bethlehem a little bit south of Jerusalem. Here are some flat roads that they traveled, but there were also mountains and treacherous paths along the way where thieves and robbers awaited to steal and take advantage of the travelers. It was not only a long journey, but there were also dangers along the way, and then just think of it. There's rolling out the sleeping bag at night, there's making a fire, there's looking for water, there's no rest stops along the way, no fast food places to stop and eat, no Motel 6, no hot tub for the weary bones. It was just plain not an easy journey. The first day of the journey, about 15, 20 miles into it, they would have come to Samaria. And going through Samaria, what's interesting is that they would have traveled the road that was called at that time the Way of the Patriarchs through Samaria, because it was there that much of the history of the Old Testament took place. For example, it was in Samaria that Abraham was shown the land that God was going to give him and his descendants forever. It was in that land that Joseph was buried. It was there that Joshua set up the Ark of the Covenant. It was along that Way of the Patriarchs, that road through Samaria, that the people of Israel would have traveled when they were led away into captivity up northwest into Babylon. And it would also be that road that the people of Israel traveled back on through Samaria when they came home rejoicing to rebuild the temple in the city of Jerusalem. Walking down that path, the Way of the Patriarchs, would have been a literal walk down memory lane of the biblical history of God's relationship with his people. The places and ways that God sought to bring his word of salvation to the descendants of the original sinners, Adam and Eve. That road through Samaria, Way of the Patriarchs, was rich with history because that's where God led his people for many generations. And now God was leading Mary and Joseph to travel that road, God not only leading them, but God with them, enfleshed in the womb of Mary. But going through Samaria also tells us a second thing that's of significance, because it shows us that Mary and Joseph, on their travel to Bethlehem for Jesus to be born, they interacted with people at that time who were considered to be unclean. Not only different from them, but sinful, unclean, worthy of their hate and disdain. That's where Mary and Joseph traveled with Jesus in Mary's womb. And when we consider the life of Jesus, think of the life of Jesus. We remember all of those times when he reached out to those who were considered unclean, those who were considered sinful, those who were considered different, those whom the religious people considered with hate and disdain. And we can only assume that Jesus' life was shaped by this journey of his parents going through Samaria. As an adult, during Jesus' travels, if you look at maps where Jesus went, he often traveled through Samaria, not around it like a good number of Jewish people traveled at that time, but Jesus would go through Samaria and actually interact with the people there and engage in ministry. In fact, when Mary and Joseph were traveling through Samaria, they may have stopped at a well for water in Samaria. Maybe even the same one where Jesus stopped at the well at Samaria, remember in John 4, where there was a woman who was there in the heat of the day. He asked her for water. She, you know, the whole story, you've had 5 husbands and one you were living with is not your husband. While traveling through Samaria, while offering those folks forgiveness and love and grace would have been shocking to many of the religious people in Jesus' days, it makes sense that Jesus did that because his parents kind of brought him up that way, traveling through Samaria for Jesus to be born. And, you know, that begs us to ask the question, are our hearts as open to other people as Mary and Joseph and Jesus were? Do we really believe that God's love and grace is deep enough to forgive and wide enough to receive everyone, even though their nationality, skin color, their life's experiences might be different than ours? Mary and Joseph were willing to open themselves to everyone and all people, even the Samaritans, like the angel. Today is good news for all the people. Jesus comes to offer grace and love and forgiveness to all those people. And when Mary and Joseph made that route, those 80 miles, breaking boundaries by going through Samaria, they finally arrived, after going through Jerusalem, at Bethlehem, the city of David. We read these words, "And while they were there, the time came for her to deliver her child, and she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling cloths and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn." That's all we have there. Now, that's all we have, no room in the inn. I mean, you sometimes wonder whether Joseph made a mistake by not, you know, calling ahead to make reservations. I mean, this was, after all, Bethlehem's Joseph's town. His family lived there. Why didn't he make reservations, or at least get a home for Mary, a place for Mary in his home? Well, all we hear in the Bible is that there was no room for them in the inn. That's all we have. No angry innkeeper, no shaking fists, no slammed doors of that innkeeper who said, "There's no room." I told you before of the Sunday School of Christmas program of the little kid who didn't always come to Sunday school, and he needed a line in the Christmas program, so the program director gave him the line of the innkeeper. The only thing he had to say was, "There's no room." And when he did that in the Christmas pageant, and Mary and Joseph and the baby went along sad, he said, "Well, there's no room, but why don't you come on in for a beer anyway?" You can imagine Dad just crawling in there. Now, that detail has led people, scholars, for many years to think Joseph's from Bethlehem, and he went to his hometown where his family was living. Why did Mary and Joseph have to go to the inn instead of Joseph's home? It's a great question. One possible answer is, if Joseph's family lived there in Bethlehem, he was of the house and lineage of David. What's interesting is that you see that they laid Jesus in a manger because there was no room in them for the inn. Now, I hope this isn't too boring, but there's a Greek word that is used for the word inn. The word is kataluma. Why don't you repeat that after me? Kataluma. Okay, kataluma is, there's no room for them in the kataluma. In the inn, it's translated as inn. But the only other time that that word kataluma is used is once in Luke chapter 2 that I just read, and second in Luke chapter 22, the word kataluma is used when Jesus says, "Why don't you go prepare the Passover meal in the kataluma, in the guest room of the house where people were staying." In Luke 2, it's translated the inn, so we think it's a hotel. But in Luke 22, it's translated as the upper room, the back room, the guest room of someone's house. So what if that was really meaning to say that Jesus was wrapped in swaddling cloths and laid in a manger because there was no room for them at the guest room of Joseph's family home? Now, if that might be the case, you might also wonder, why did Joseph's family not give the guest room to Mary and Joseph? Well, according to Jewish law at the time, when a woman gave birth, because of the blood involved in the process of childhood, the woman and all that she touched and everything that she came in contact with in giving birth would be unclean for a week or 2 weeks, which meant that if Mary would have given birth in the kataluma, in the guest room of the family home, that would have been off limits then for that whole time for any of Joseph's family who were also coming to be received into the census. Most rooms at that time had only one guest rooms, which means that Joseph's family would have been displaced. And so she gave birth in a stable, which at the time of Jesus, many houses had stables connected right to their house. Not out in the back 40, but stables where they kept their family animals, horses and all of that, connected right to the house. Maybe this stable that she gave birth in was not in a way stable, but a stable connected to the family home, which meant that the family would have been there if they were needed during the birth of Jesus. I think maybe that's a little different way to think about the birth of Jesus, which is actually closer to Luke's actual words about the way that the story of Jesus is told. Maybe a little different way than the traditional preaching about the birth of Jesus. I mean, I, in my early years, preached a sermon on the angry innkeeper. And the point of it was, don't be an angry innkeeper. Let Jesus into your heart. Well, that's kind of misconstructed from the actual words of Jesus. What a better place, the stable, familiar place for Joseph. Maybe the stable, the manger that was there, was one that Joseph made with his father that now he is putting his baby Jesus in. What a better place for Jesus to be born. What a better way to say that in all situations God provides. God provides a way in his upper story that always makes sense, even though the details in our lower story doesn't always make sense. So, you know that 80-mile journey that they took from Nazareth to Bethlehem? Likely, it was an unwanted journey. An unwanted journey. Maybe sometime in your life you've taken an unwanted journey. If you haven't already taken an unwanted journey, likely you will in the next number of years. An unwanted journey might be being laid off. An unwanted journey might be living with cancer. An unwanted journey might be having children who are just making poor decisions that are affecting not only them, but also others. An unwanted journey might be trying to keep clean and sober for one day at a time. An unwanted journey might be deciding that you need to do what it takes to keep you safe in an abusive relationship. An unwanted journey might be the death of a loved one. Life does have, whether we like it or not, unwanted journeys that will bring us oftentimes to the point of pain and despair. But the good news is that God always provides. God always provides. And God walks with us on our journeys, even though they might be unwanted. And God always redeems and brings good from them. The Bible is full of those stories of reversals. Joseph being sold by his brothers into slavery, but God using that to save the people of Israel. The Babylonians destroyed the temple in Jerusalem and marched the brightest and best into captivity. But 50 years later, they came back singing and rebuilt the temple. There's always so many ways that God does that that God redeems us as we're putting one foot in front of the other in the middle of those unwanted journeys, where we need to remember that God does redeem us. God does redeem those unwanted journeys, and God will always bring us back to him. So we need to remember those unwanted journeys that Mary and Joseph took, and the unwanted journey that we sometimes take to remind us beyond a shadow of a doubt that Jesus never promised that his faithful followers would have an easy journey through life, but he did. He did promise them a safe arrival in heaven. That's how God redeems our journey through life. And so God is always looking for people who respond to his call like Mary did. Like Mary did. This week, ask yourself the question, when was the last time you took a risk to pursue what you believed that God was calling you to do? When was the last time you did something that made you just a little bit afraid? Can you be willing and open like Mary? Because God is looking for those who respond to his call, just like Mary did. Be open, be willing, like Mary, and let God redeem your journey through life. Let's close with prayer. Gracious God, we all go on journeys through life, sometimes planned, sometimes unplanned, sometimes even unwanted. Dear God, like Mary, like Joseph, help us to respond to your call on our lives. Dear God, bless us this season. Help us to prepare our hearts to receive Jesus as the most important gift that we get from you this holy season. In Jesus' name, amen. And let's stand and sing.